I just wanted to start by saying, before I pass you over to Dr. Bettina Henzler, who's going to be your host for this afternoon's session, I just wanted to say a note of thanks to our keynote speaker, Nathalie Bourgeois, for joining us today. I understand that this is a challenging moment for Nathalie and her team, so we're very grateful that she has taken the time to come and share her experiences with us today. I also just wanted to add, on a personal note, a note of support from my colleagues at the Film Education Journal. It's my understanding, and Nathalie can correct me if I'm wrong, that the Cinéma Centre de Jeunesse project that Nathalie's going to be talking about today is currently experiencing a period of challenge and uncertainty. And I wanted, in the strongest possible terms, to voice our collective support and solidarity for Nathalie and her team. My own engagement with film education began with working with the Cinéma Centre de Jeunesse project. And 10 years later, I am still drawing on the wealth of experience that I gained through working alongside Nathalie and her team. And I am exceptionally grateful, and I kind of feel that everything that we are currently doing with the Film Education Journal and the Scottish International Film Education Conference is highly indebted to the work of Nathalie and her team. Our very first edition explored the work of the Cinéma Centre de Jeunesse project, and since then we have frequently returned again and again to the excellent work that Cinéma Centre de Jeunesse continues to do. So for those in the international film education community joining us today, I would urge you to think, as I'm thinking myself, about the ways in which we can continue to support Cinéma Centre de Jeunesse in any ways that we can. It remains, in my own experience, the most interesting, progressive and visionary film education project I've been involved with, and a source of continual ongoing value. So when we were deciding our conference programme today, it was very clear to me who should be giving the keynote and about what. So I am extremely grateful to Nathalie for joining us, and I'm also very grateful to Bettina for hosting this afternoon's session. I'll pass over to Bettina now. Thank you both.
Thank you very much, Jamie, for this very wonderful words, which I can just share. I'm completely of the same opinion as Jamie. I'm coming from Germany, in Berlin. I'm working between film studies and film education for a long time now. And I was especially interested in the French cinephile, French approaches of film education, which are rather on aesthetic and film history and filmmaking. And Cinéma Centre de Jeunesse is one of the most interesting, if not the most interesting, projects of this tradition. And so I'm very happy to introduce it to you today. Before I pass to Nathalie, just a few words about her and the project. Nathalie Bourgeois did important pioneering work in film education in France as well as in Europe. She founded the pedagogical service of the Cinémathèque Française in 1993, which she directed over 25 years. In this function, she co-founded, together with Alain Bergala and others, the international film education project, the Cinéma Centre de Jeunesse, in 1995, which became one of the oldest and most important international film education projects in Europe. Since then, she also contributed as pedagogical advisor to various other European and international film education projects, such as CINED, Inside Cinema, Framework for Film Education, that are nourished by her long-term experience. Based on her wide-ranging experience in film education, she also produced pedagogical materials and tools that are particularly inventive. Just to name two that I find particularly interesting, in 2002, she produced one of the first digital tools for film education, the DVD Petit à Petit Le Cinéma, which was published in the series Laden Cinema that Alain Bergala edited during 10 years. And this DVD was already based on the combination of film extracts that offers diverse pathways to fundamental questions of cinema. And it's for young children, it's for the made for the work with young children, but I can say that I worked with students with this DVD for a long time, and it's really a great a great tool to introduce all kinds of people to the art and history of cinema. Then there's one more addition I would like to point to. This is a series of books for young children that Nathalie edited, where people wrote on film history, but it addressed young people and children. And the book Nathalie wrote in this was Grand Petit, Big and Small in Cinema. And I very much love those books, which are really, I didn't see anything like this before and after. So just to say this about Nathalie and a few more words about Cinéma Centre Jeunesse, which is a project that already developed a methodology that combines film analysis, film history and filmmaking in 1993. And in principle, it was anticipating what will happen with digitization later after 2000, because they already proposed to work with film extracts. They already envisaged to combine film analysis and practice, which is something which became more and more important today. And perhaps to frame it once more, this project, they experimented the aesthetic approach and methodology that Alain Bergala described in his essay, Hypothesis Cinema, that was already written in 2002 and translated into English in 2016, and which was, as far as I know, an inspiration for the creation of the film education journal, as Jamie just said. So it's really a very interesting and rich experience what Nathalie will share with us now. So I hand over to you, Nathalie.
So thank you for all your work. You said everything. Thank you. Yes, I'm very, very happy to be very pleased. Thank you for this invitation. And I begin to apologize for my English because I'm not, I hope you will understand me, but and then we will have time for questions at the end of the conference if you don't understand me. But I wanted to say first that when the Cinémathèque Française, which has been coordinating the CCIJ programs from the beginning, they announced that they were abandoning the program, many texts were sent out in support. And while the Cinémathèque was careful to recognize the value of the CCIJ is the short name for Cinéma Centre Jeunesse, this decision was very difficult to understand for those involved in the program and for its funders, especially because the CCIJ is in full expansion now. So each of these texts said in a different way, according to the different points of view of their authors, what the CCIJ is, and all with a great accuracy, what it means to each of them with great intensity. And as I read them, I thought that each of these participants could have been presented the CCIJ to you as well as I do today, really, or even better. And I consider that it is a very good thing. Nevertheless, I will do my best to report on the issues and the current situation of the program from my position, so being involved in the origin of the project. Just to say, last week, we just organized the CCIJ meeting of 2021, and they were held for the last time at the Cinémathèque. Despite the restrictive sanitary measures, this was just amazing. One more time. So I have to admit that it will be difficult for me to hide in this conference the enthusiasm that this initiative still arouses in me. To begin with, I propose you two testimonies that were collected during the previous CCIJ meetings. There are two actresses and directors, Sandrine Bonner and Noémie Lovski. They came to the Cinémathèque to discover the students' films and to discuss with the pupils. So just we can play the two extracts of interviews with them, please.
Thank you. première question par rapport à ce que vous avez vu aujourd'hui. Vous avez vu des jeunes qui ont entre 6 et 20 ans parler de cinéma, montrer leurs films. Et bah, le cinéma est aussi venu assez tôt dans votre vie avec À nos amours. Qu'est-ce que ça vous a inspiré de voir ces jeunes gens justement rencontrer le cinéma aujourd'hui? Qu'est-ce que vous en avez pensé?
D'abord, j'ai beaucoup aimé les deux films. Ce que je trouve fascinant, c'est qu'ils font tout. Et puis, ils sont assez nombreux et ils ont l'air de bien s'entendre. Ce qui n'est pas évident parce que qui fait quoi et comment les choses sont départagées. Déjà, ça, ce n'est pas simple à mettre en place. C'est déjà une mise en scène en soi, je trouve. Je trouve très doué. Et c'est ce que je disais à Nathalie qui m'a invité à venir. Je lui disais, mais il faut les produire. De produire, de les encourager à faire d'autres films et qu'ils fassent des films qui ne soient pas que dans le cadre d'une école. Il faut les faire connaître, en tout cas les deux films que j'ai vus. J'étais très très sensible au premier film. Je le trouvais très construit, très pensé, très écrit, très joliment écrit. Ça fait chaud au cœur de voir qu'il y ait des gens comme ça aussi doués. Surtout avec l'âge qu'ils ont, mais c'est très jeune. Même s'ils sont encadrés par des adultes, c'est quand même eux qui font tout, quoi. C'est formidable.
Il y a quelque chose qui ne va pas. Je le vois bien.
Comment tu peux voir ça, avec le dos tourné?
Je ne le vois pas, je le sens. Ton dos est comme une pierre. Il ne respire pas.
Justement, on parlait du film Corse, le jeune garçon qui joue le rôle principal avec les unes. Expliquer que ce qu'il y a dans son, c'est ce qui lui a révélé sa rencontre avec le cinéma et ce que ça a pu créer dans sa vie. Et j'aurais envie de savoir, à votre avis, qu'est-ce que ça apporte à ces jeunes gens dans une vie? Qu'est-ce que ça peut chambouler? Et vous-même, à 15 ans, qu'est-ce que ça a changé dans votre vie?
Mais je pense que j'y suis sensible aussi pour cette raison-là, de ce film-là, dans le sens où moi, je viens d'une famille assez populaire, le cinéma, on n'y allait pas. Donc je regardais des films à la télé, mais le cinéma a totalement bousculé ma vie, a changé ma vie et celle de ma famille. C'est quand même un des métiers où, qui pousse au rêve, à des rencontres, à la création, à tout ça. Donc c'est un vrai cadeau. Et c'est vrai que c'est très beau, le sujet est magnifique. Avoir envie de partir d'un personnage comme ça qui n'a pas envie, qui n'a envie de rien et qui, et grâce au cinéma, grâce à cette caméra qu'il va prendre dans ses mains, sa vie va changer, il va dans la symbolique. Il est tout le temps assis et puis dès qu'il a cette caméra, tout d'un coup, c'est ce qui va l'aider à se lever, à sourire à nouveau, à aimer la vie.
Est-ce que je suis épatée par ce que j'ai vu aujourd'hui? Je suis vraiment épatée. Alors, j'ai pas vu tous les films. J'ai vu un film qui s'appelle Un mal pour un bien, qui a été fait par des élèves de 3e et qui est très, 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 très beau. Très beau, vraiment. Enfin, j'étais épatée parce que c'est un film qui est vraiment mis en scène. Il y a des plans, les plans sont pensés, il y a une histoire comme ça qui se raconte, qui se déploie et qui est tout le temps intéressante. Donc on est tenu comme ça, tout le temps sur des petits riens, on est en haleine sur des petites choses. Il y a des personnages, les acteurs jouent tous très 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 bien, vraiment très bien. Et ouais, c'est un émerveillement de voir un film comme ça fait par un groupe d'élèves de 3e. Et puis, j'ai vu aussi un montage. On a demandé aux enfants et aux adolescents de filmer leur jeu. Et donc, il n'y a pas de dialogue. C'est un montage de 24 minutes. Et on voit des enfants et des adolescents qui jouent à toutes sortes de jeux. À des jeux de groupe, à des jeux à deux, à des jeux seuls même, il me semble, oui. c'est très très beau. Il y a une chose qui est très très belle, c'est que c'est des jeux qui traversent les époques. Ils y jouent là en 2017, mais je peux très bien imaginer qu'à la fin du 19e, ils jouaient au même jeu et même avant. Ça, c'est très très beau, et puis c'est très beau parce que c'est des corps et du mouvement. Ils jouent à des jeux de main, ils jouent à sauter. Et puis on a les gens, quand ils jouent, ont un visage magnifique parce que c'est un visage qui s'oublie et qui oublie qu'il est regardé.
Non. Voilà. Donc, c'était une introduction du... Oh, sorry, in English. To introduce my presentation, to say how people speak of the project, and when filmmakers meet this program, how do they react? And now I'm going to tell you something about this program, even if maybe some of you already know it, but I think for others I have to explain a little. So this program is quite an experimental program with a sobering history and longevity. It was, as Bettina said, created in France in 1995, while other film education programs were launched in France, école, collège, and lycéen au cinéma. But it was not created by a political decision because of the desire of a small group of teachers, directors, of representatives of structures, mainly archives, who wanted to join forces to share an educational experience. And it is also this program, the heritage of a thought on the pedagogy of cinema transmitted by Alain Bergala, as Bettina said. So this centenary of the cinema in 1995, it was an opportunity. And also the creation of an educational service at the Cinémathèque Française, for which the director at the time, it was Dominique Payny, he gave me carte blanche. So the first year of the CCIG was really full of surprises, because this program immediately aroused the enthusiasm of those who took part. And it gave rise to a harvest of incredible Lumière Minute shot during the winter of 1995 in Super 8 by children and teenagers from several regions of France. From this came a feature film in 35 millimeters composed by a selection of these Lumière Minutes. And this film, it is Jeune Lumière, was presented at the Cannes Festival, and then the film circulated through festivals and arousing interest. And this was really the founding act of the program. And so we decided to continue beyond the centenary of cinema, and the program was open to new regions, always in France. Then next step, it's in 2000, artistic education was strongly supported in France by a political will with the Arts in Schools plan, which was promoted by Jack Lang, you know, then Minister of Education, and Catherine Tasca, Minister of Culture. And Bergala became Lang's film advisor, and he wrote this founding book on film education, Bettina said, L'Hypothèse Cinéma. This book was important for the cinema Centre Jeunesse because it began to be more widely known, as Bergala said that this program had been inspiring for him. So the CCIG then developed through meetings between people. These meetings were decisive, and maybe it's important to say that the integration of new partners was always played out on a human level. We were first approached by people who were trying to develop film education in their country, often through small associations or archive. And this is how the CCIJ became European, even before the implementation of the education project supported by Europe Creative, with the participation of first Spain, Portugal, Italy, and other Mediterranean countries, soon joined by the United Kingdom, Germany, Finland, Lithuania, Bulgaria, among others. And in 2010, so 5 years later, a new step was reached when, with the arrival of Brazil, followed by other Latin American countries, and then Japan, India, and so on. This meant that the CCIJ could adapt to all sorts of different contexts. And finally, I think the last significant step in the opening of the CCIJ was the setting up of an educational website, website of resources open to all teachers, students, speakers. This website, so it is inspired by the CCIJ experiments, and it proposes to explore cinema through questions such as shown or hidden, color, reality in fiction, places and stories, and so on. You will find film extracts, analysis, pedagogical tracks, but also films made by children in workshops. It is available in French, in English, thanks to the BFI and the Scottish Film Education, and also in Spanish. So there will be, I think, a link in the chat so you can discover it. Well, the CCIJ remains a program marked by its origin, its France. It's the French cinephilia, the French approach to film education as an art. And it is present in 8 regions in France, metropolitan and overseas. But now it also involves 16 countries around the world. So that's the situation. And maybe we have to say why we think it's a unique program. It's quite unique because even if it has developed, it remains faithful to its original vocation as a research laboratory, research based on experimentation in the field. So very simple principles, but well articulated. So each year about 40 workshops are set up, and they involve about 1,000 students. They are for pupils of a wide age range, because the youngest are 6 and the oldest 18 years old. They are run throughout the school year, supervised by a pair, a teacher and an external speaker, with a film director or film technician, who visits the class and works with the same workshop throughout the year. The adults who supervise the workshops, so the teachers, the speakers, and also the local coordinators, they meet several times during the year, and they share training and exchanges time together. First in September, it is the initial training to launch the workshops. In spring, it's a midterm meeting where the first exercises shot in the workshops are presented and commented on. And then in June, they meet again for the screening of all the films made in the workshops, this time with the pupils. So even if some of you already know, as I said, all this by heart, maybe it's time to recall some basic of the principles implemented since the beginning of the program. What is it? It is exploring rather than transmitting. It means that each year there is a new subject that is chosen to explore the cinema, so the years follow each other but are not alike. No repetition, no boredom. All participants must be involved in this exploration, the teachers, the film practitioners, and the students. It is, to quote Alain Bergala, a pedagogy that calls upon the imagination and personal intelligence of each person. It's not the transmission of a knowledge. No speech is asserted, no recipe is delivered. Things are built up little by little in the mind of each person in a different way, according to what they are, but always with common denominators. So, first thing. Second thing important, taking the time. These workshops allow you to work over a whole school year, which is rare, and give you time to appropriate it, to experience it. Whether in or out of school, each workshop takes place over a minimum of 50 hours, spread out between October and June in regular sessions. The program leaves time and space for each person according to his or her personality, to get closer to the subject, to experience it, and to build their own path. Third, the rules of game. They are invented each year to explore the annual subject in the workshops, and they will be shared with the pupils, whatever their age, their social backgrounds, the diversity of their living areas, because we have a workshop in big cities, little villages, rural areas, islands, and so on. And so, rules of game, of course, it is a constraint because there are rules, but it also makes the program a great collective game. They are structuring and unifying between the different workshops, but we are really careful to ensure that they allow the pupils a great deal of freedom in the choice of what they are going to tell and film. They are a guide, but they take a backseat to the story being told. Another point is individual collective. In order to take in account the personal and sensitive dimension of each person, the students first shoot individual exercises, and only in a second time, they make a short film as a group, and so then they experiment the collective dimension linked to the making of cinema. Next, we do not choose between watching or making films, but we articulate them. We combine theory and practice in a dynamic way. As you know, most often, these are distinct approaches. Very often, as either you watch film with children and you analyze them, or you make film and you are mainly absorbed with the technical aspect of cinema. Here, the famous va-et-vient between film analysis and experimentation is really a stimulating process. Film extracts, so it enables adults first and then students to understand the chosen subjects. During the initial training, there are around 80 extracts on the subject that are selected, and they are selected through the whole history of cinema and cinematographies. These extracts are given to the adult participants. They are classified, carefully chosen, and they are put online or distributed in the form of a DVD. And this is the same extract that will be viewed in class with the students. This is so a precious tool that everyone can use according to their tastes and according to the audience of their workshop, of course. And also this film accept pedagogy that is advocated by Alain Bergala is now beginning to be recognized. Approaching films with experts was really not obvious at the beginning of the CCIG in the 19s. It was something really like a sacrilege, almost in the archives, not to see the whole film, but just excerpts. So this is one of the evolution of the CCIG. Do I need to say why working with film excerpt is a good thing? No, I think everyone is okay with that, but maybe it's a good thing to tell one more time that first, we have all experienced that an excerpt creates a desire to see the whole film. And so it is a way students can be curious about films they wouldn't otherwise never want to see. Then it evokes an emotion in students. It appeals to the senses without a logic of stimuli and responses in which everything is predictable. Because when you see a film extract, then you can talk. It gives you the possibility of imagination, confrontation of ideas and debate. And so the teacher is more a facilitator of discovery, like a pathfinder, rather than a provider of knowledge in this case. And when you compare several stagings of the same situation, for instance, it invites you to speak out. Everyone can dare to express themselves. Everyone has ideas if you compare extracts. Of course, it has to be well chosen before. It's not only at random, but this confrontation of different aesthetic approaches is also very inspiring when there is practice. They are not models to be reproduced, but by their diversity, they invite each one to situate himself, to make his own choices. And each year we are struck by how some extracts are assimilated in the students' own films. So that was for the big principles. Then I wanted to focus on a question that is the question of training, because it is like a peer-to-peer program. And this is, I think, another characteristic of the CCIG, to be a collaborative program. And this program creates real and lasting links between different categories of people involved in film education. These people don't meet so often. Teachers from the first and the second grade, they don't meet. Directors, cinema programmers, educators. And what is really important is that to bring them together on several occasions to enable them to approach the subject of the year, but exactly with the same knowledge. I mean, there is not a training for the teachers and one for the professionals. And there is not one group favored over another, but they are involved at the same time, and that makes a difference. Because, of course, in the group we have real professionals and people and academics who know much about cinema, and also we have teachers who just like cinema, but sometimes they don't know much about it. So this is quite difficult, and this is a challenge. And the challenge is, okay, because it's someone like Alain Bergala for the initial training, and the thinking of Bergala is quite a common thread for this program. Because he managed to address the trainees as peers. And it is more like a conversation, especially with participants who are already familiar with the program from previous years. And the participants are also invited to propose film extracts themselves. So this analysis of film extracts during the training, it is very rich because it's raising questions for the work with pupils. It's not only an analysis. It's an analysis for a pedagogical purpose. And it opens up avenues because, unlike a traditional course, there is a precise objective to be achieved, the production of film that will be screened. So it's not like an usual training. And also, I think this program is untypical because it works on self-assessment, on having others look at and comment on, on having others look at and comment on your work. It means everyone is encouraged to express themselves on the work of others. And it's not easy to speak on each work and on the works of others. And this is mostly the midterm review because, as I said, each adult comes, the teachers, the speakers, to present the exercises shot by the students in the first part of the year. And then they exchange on it. And people manage to know each other better. They can compare the different interpretations of the rules of games of the exercises. And at the same time, each year a blog is created. The students write about their impressions, the films they have seen, their shootings, and also the exercises will be put online in the blog so they can see what the others have done and put their work into perspectives with that of the others. They can react, ask questions, and also it prepares the collective film. But just to be sure you understand, they are not gathered, they are not together. Only the adults talk together in the midterm review. The students just share the blog and they meet at the end for the final screening. For the final screening, there are also the adults and the students. And it's really a crucial stage because, as you know, watching a film in a classroom, watching your film, not a film, your film in a classroom, or discovering it in a real cinema theater on a big screen, like it was at the Cinémathèque Française, for instance, it really makes a difference. Because it's no more your thing. It has its own life. And the presentation is not a competition. There are no prizes, no palmarès. And what matters is the capacity of each person, first the students, but also the adults, to testify to a process, to express themselves on the work of others. And each year, we are so surprised to see how these students were here, they argue and they defend their choices. What does it mean? That they really have time to integrate, to be familiar with the subject of the year, because they have watching so many extras, do so many exercises, and so they are really comfortable with that. And this screening is not an end, but it's more than the opening of new horizons, new questions. And as I always say, and it was the same for the previous meeting, it's very moving moment because they come to discuss after the screening of the showing of their film. And it's the moment when the teacher and the speaker, they listen to the students that are answering to the question of the audience. And at this time, the teacher and the speaker, they really discover what the students have understood from the experience. And this year again, some people came and said, wow, I thought they didn't understand, but no, they really got all the process. And during the shooting of the film, they were not very concentrated, but in fact, yes, they have understood. So it's it's a crucial moment. And during this last meeting, it was last week, it just happened. We watched 8 films of 10 minutes, because each film is about 10 minutes, during 3 afternoons. It means 24 films in total. And the films were followed by discussions. And we managed to understand each other despite the language differences. And it's a small economy. So adults improvise translations. We managed to get by. So great was the interest in other ways of life, other places, other languages, because there are films from 16 countries that are presented. And really, 8 films in 4 hours is a lot. And it's clear that the pupils, they don't come here just for their own film. Whatever they age, their age, from 10 to 18 this year, they show so much attention. They are so benevolent, so curious for the film of the others, that one thinks that you can really think that something has really happened for them in this year of cinema. Not only because of their film, but because the way they want to watch the film of others and to talk about it. And then we will see other images. Don't worry, I'm speaking a bit again, but you will see things I'm talking about. One more point. Why, in fact, I listened to Jamie, to Bettina, and why this program is so important, and why is it leaving such mark on those who are involved in CCLG? So I try to explain it, but maybe you will complete. I think, first, this program has the capacity to welcome participants of different sensibilities. For some of them, it was their own approach of cinema education, and they integrated themselves smoothly and very naturally. For others, they needed a period of adaptation, the time to find out how to appropriate this proposal. And for me, this case is particularly interesting, the second case. In the end, this program brings together a real community, very diverse. This year, especially, the attachment of the participants to this little utopia was just amazing. So why? Maybe it has to do with personal commitment, risk-taking, because it is a permanent questioning of one's experience, both as a spectator and as an educator. Everyone is personally involved in this project. There are some constraints, the common subject, the rules of game that are given, but each person is free to use or not to use the tools that are proposed and to imagine their own path. Everyone must also find their place in the system, in this community. So many participants remain over many years. And I guess that it's because the CCLG provides them with a space for reflection, because it's not so easy to keep training in a life when you're a teacher or a filmmaker. And also it gives you a community of peers with whom you can share your experience. And it's so easy to feel isolated when you work, even if you work with a workshop, but it's your workshop alone. So for the teachers, the in-depth work over a whole school year in collaboration with the film professional, it allows them to train, to acquire methodology, confidence for their future artistic projects. But I think even more, it's more than that. This program makes the teacher's personal relationship with cinema resonate. And this is what a teacher told me. In this program, you are obliged to reveal your own relationship with the cinema. You are told, come as you are, it's your responsibility. You can leave or stay, nobody forces you. If you have found something personal in the program, you stay. If not, you go on your way. So the risk-taking shared with the speaker is a major pedagogical virtue. No one has control over the subject because it's each year a new subject. It's a really collective research on a new question of cinema. Like we say, everyone does the research and starts researching in action. The teacher searches with the pupils without knowing the solution. So the teacher has to accept that he or she is not ahead of the students, who understand that we trust them, that we are looking together. And another teacher's testimony, the freedom given to conduct the workshop requires a real involvement. At the beginning, you are not asked to know much about cinema. As a result, it is very demanding. You are asked to make the students understand something about it, which is not evaluated. So this is mostly for the teachers, but also for the filmmakers. They say that this approach forces them to slow down because they have to think about the reason for each choice in the creative process when they work with children. And also it's for them a real opportunity to question specific aspects of cinema through the choice of the annual subject. You can imagine if you dedicate 1 year to the role of color or to the role of weather in cinema, it makes you see films in a different way after that. And so, of course, it is a way they question their own practice of cinema with such workshops. They are not only those who know the technical points. No, they have to do also the research because of the subject chosen. For the students, then it's a chance to be, of course, in contact, in direct contact with the professionals, with those who make the cinema. And as we say, it's really a chance to rediscover the daily environment that in a different way, because it is made, the films are made with very simple things, where they live, their stories, but these workshops really help them to, some of them, to begin to become visible. And for all of them, it is a way to make up their life, their stories, their feelings, and to share it with others all over the world. And that's really an important dimension of the project. It is like, you say, a window on the world for them. And again, this year, the students who came to present their film told us how much the cinema experience has created brand new and strong links between them within the class. So this eruption of the cinema for a whole year is a very significant experience, whatever their age. Sometimes it leads to a real change in their lives, sometimes not, but it always leaves traces that we cannot suspect. So here are the videos again, so with some testimonies we collected. It was for the 25th anniversary of the CCIG, and you can find also them on the website. And we asked many students who have participated to the CCIG to remember this experience. So we will see three videos of these testimonies.
Hi, my name is Sky Hope. I took part in the project in 2017 to 2018 in Scotland. My role in the film was one of the girls who was friends with the main character. Some of the locations we used was our local church, St. Vigen's Church. It was amazing filming there. We found out so much about the church that we didn't know before. The stuff I found most difficult was the acting, as it's very scary being on camera. Some of my favorite things about the project were getting to use all the equipment and learning how to act the way we did. And going to Edinburgh to showcase the film to everyone, seeing all the other schools' movies, and just all the stuff in general. It was just fun to do.
Well, I think it's cool that you're a Kelpie and that you didn't eat us. But if you don't mind, I'd like to get out of this creepy place.
Yeah, that would be fine.
You're it. I see myself being involved in the filmmaking in future in ways, maybe acting, maybe sound. I really enjoyed doing sound.
Bonjour, je m'appelle Harika, je suis étudiante, j'habite à India, j'ai 12 ans. That's only, but that's all the French I know, but I'm learning, so yeah. I took part in the CCJ workshop from 2017 to 2018, the theme for that year was spaces and the stories they tell. I vividly remember the day we went to the beach for our last shoot. I remember that it was really hot and the sand kept on getting inside our clothes and it was like so itchy. And also we were racing to complete the shots in the right time. So it was really hectic, but in the end when I saw the film at the convocation on the big screen in France, I was really impressed and proud of me and my group and what a good film we had made. I was really scared as I was the only person from our group that day, and I was really nervous of going and representing a film on my own on the stage in front of so many people. But taking a deep breath, I went, and it turned out it was not that scary. And in fact, I became really comfortable, and I was really happy to be among so many people. So, and that was a really good experience for me.
Bonjour, je m'appelle Eladji, j'ai 20 ans. J'ai participé au projet 100 ans de jeunesse quand j'avais 12 ans, 13 ans. Le thème de l'année était la part de réel dans la fiction. On prenait des morceaux de choses qui se passaient dans la vie réelle pour l'apporter dans notre film, pour lui donner plus de force. Je me souviens d'un truc particulier sur le tournage. On était sur les quais de Seine et j'étais assis sur une bite d'amarrage. Et à ce moment-là, il y a une péniche qui entrait en scène et on la voyait arriver. Et ce n'était pas prévu du tout. Et tout le monde a bien anticipé, a suivi le mouvement, l'équipe technique comme l'acteur, etc. J'étais assis sur la bite d'amarrage. Une dame m'a demandé de me lever pour mettre la corde autour. Et elle a mis la corde autour, juste après elle m'a proposé de me rasseoir. Je me suis rassis et on a tourné la scène, la femme a joué le jeu. C'était vraiment super. Et du coup, c'était vraiment un vrai moment de réel dans la fiction. moi, franchement, j'en perds mes mots, en fait, parce que je ne me disais pas que ça allait me plaire de jouer derrière une caméra ou quoi. Mais dès que j'y étais, ça a été, j'ai été facilement conduit par Madame Bagnon. Et franchement, ça m'a permis de me concentrer, d'apprendre à me concentrer, parce que j'étais très jeune et un peu turbulent avant. Je me souviens du jour où le court-métrage a été projeté à la Cinémathèque. C'était la première fois que je le voyais, car j'avais quitté l'école 2 mois auparavant et je n'avais pas participé au montage, malheureusement. Et franchement, c'était la première fois que je me voyais sur un grand écran, etc. J'étais... je ne sais pas... Le fait d'avoir participé au court-métrage et d'avoir été acteur m'a permis de prendre confiance en moi, une vraie confiance, et m'a permis de aussi ne pas me fixer de limites et me dire que pourquoi pas, moi aussi, je pourrais plus tard devenir quelqu'un du monde du cinéma. J'ai tourné un court-métrage il y a 2 ans, mon deuxième court-métrage où j'étais acteur principal, pardon. Et ensuite, je tourne une série web où je suis le co-réalisateur et je suis acteur aussi. Et j'ai réalisé un court-métrage qui est en cours de montage. Et franchement, c'est une chose qui me plaît beaucoup. Je suis vraiment passionné par le cinéma. Et je vais tout faire pour vraiment arriver jusqu'au bout de mes rêves. Merci au cinéma 100 ans de jeunesse de m'avoir fait vivre cette expérience.
So, it was really... it was a real spontaneous testimonies. we have many on the website if you want to have a look from different countries. So as I'm a bit late, I will go maybe now to the question of the today, and this is a turning point, and what are the perspectives, and what analyze can we do on the current situation on the spot. For me, there are two decisive elements of context. First, this is that up to now, for 27 years, the Cinémathèque Française has supported the project Cinéma 100 ans de jeunesse, because it was born, as you know, at the same time as its educational department, which I created and directed for 20 years. And both have grown up together, Cinéma 100 ans de jeunesse and the educational department, and they were linked, of course. And this gave the program a great symbolic strength, the possibility of a coordination with a small team of 3 people and very good conditions for hosting meetings and screenings. Over the last 15 years, the Cinémathèque has become a quite large cultural institution, developing a much wider offer with temporary exhibitions, conferences. So it has a bit changed because it became bigger. And today, I think maybe the educational action seems to be mainly in charge of going with the different programmatic proposal of the Cinémathèque. It is something that is expected from the educational department. So over time, the gap has become wider with the CCIG, because the CCIG has its own driving force, and this program has been perceived as a bit of an external laboratory. And also its vocation to disseminate on a national, European, and international scale seems to be no longer a priority for the Cinémathèque. For the moment, it seems, because I'm not sure of nothing, so it's what they say, that they wish to refocus on educational proposals to bring an audience within the Cinémathèque rather than to disseminate. So that's the first point. On the other hand, we have just gone through a very difficult year with the lockdown. Unfortunately, the CCIJ has succeeded in adapting to the online meetings. And even this has had a benefit because the impossibility of organizing the workshops in class at certain times of the year, it has encouraged individual filming by the students with mobile phones in the private sphere. And it brings another dimension to the project, and we will keep it in the future. And it was because of the lockdown, in a way. But as you said at the beginning, we were discussing, however, to those who suggest that this international program could continue in a lighter way by organizing all the meetings online, we really can testify the day after the June meetings that no, the face-to-face meeting is necessary for these exchanges between the participants of CCIJ. In this project, people need to see and speak to each other in real life. Not only in this project, but in this project, we can't imagine to do it only in a virtual way. It makes no sense. So what are the perspectives now? First, the program should not interrupt. And it's the only thing I have in my head. And not only me, but it's the most important thing. It should not interrupt. But because of the very short deadline given by the Cinémathèque, we are committed to a year of transition starting next fall. So I see, but it's really on the spot because I see three main lines of action that are taking shape. First, I don't know if the English word is right, but it's activism. It means that we will continue on a different scale by reviving the militancy of the founding group of the program in its early days. We can count on the strong investment of the partners who coordinate the workshops in the regions of France and in the different countries. Their financial commitment, because each one assumes the majority of its own costs according to a system of co-production, but not only financial commitment, but also intellectual and even emotional commitment. So we are trying to organize a more shared coordination between the partners in the future. We try to do that. And I just want to thank, I don't know if there is Mark of the BFI and other people there, and I want to thank all of them for this stimulating commitment at this delicate moment, because especially some of them, like the DFF and others, that are really helping us to create this future. And at the same time, a small association called CCIJ has been created to gather all the resources produced by the program since its creation, to gather all the films, everything in an association. But next year, the CCIJ meetings will be hosted by partners from the east of Paris, two associations and a cinema in Pantin. Pantin is very close to Paris and it's very nice cinema, and we will have all the meetings there. This return to an associative dimension with committed partners may be an opportunity for a new lease of life. However, it's not everything is not pink, because the financing of a general coordination team, which is needed, which is essential, is not yet assured and remains problematic. We were a team of three people and we don't know how we will go on, but we will find out. Then After activism, there is Europe, because CCRJ has intersected with other European programs supported by Creative Europe, or it has inspired them. For instance, the CINED project is CCRJ is the educational coordinator of this great project. And we are also trying to obtain European funding, for instance, through an Erasmus Plus over 3 years, led by one of our dear partners, the Deutsches Film Institute in Germany. So, but if you have already applied for European projects, you maybe know nothing is guaranteed, of course, and finding the match between an existing program and the expectations of Europe Creative is not always easy. So one of the great interests of this Erasmus Plus would be to be able to associate researchers in 2 universities, with the Universities of Bremen, with Bettina Henzler, and with the University of Sorbonne Nouvelle in Paris. They will create a group of research on film pedagogy based on the CCRJ. Third point, the cinematics. Another avenues open to the CCRJ is to strengthen its links with archives. Many film libraries already participate in the CCRJ. So that is why 5 film education experts from the ACE is the Association of European Cinematheques in 5 European countries got together to write to the executive committee about the fact that CCRJ is a project with unique quality and it must go on. It was the BFI, Cinémathèque Portugaise, Cinémathèque Royale de Belgique, DFF, so Deutsches Film Institute, and Deutsche Kinemathèque in Berlin. The SAE welcomed this initiative on their last assembly and agreed to the spiritual adoption of the program as key film education initiative that furthers the missions of cinematheques worldwide. And at the next Cinema Ritrovato in Bologna this year, the next concrete step will be discussed, and maybe I'll present CCRJ to a wider circle of ACE members so that this spiritual adoption becomes official. So it's also another goal to open the CCRJ to new archives in other countries that are really willing to participate. And then we can imagine to be in touch with the International Federation of Archives, the FIAF, and also link to smaller regional cinematheques. So this is a crucial point, both symbolically for the future, because it is how the project will remain in the cinematheque ADN, and also for the fundings it can help to find. So I will conclude. Sorry, I was a bit long. So I think this program is quite a generous program because it has spread and allowed so many structures to develop their own film education in many countries. And also it is now internationally recognized. It is not really identified in the film education landscape. People often say it is like marginal, but this marginal status gives it fragility, but also strength. And you know, of course, the way Jean-Luc Godard says, the margin is what holds the pages of the notebook together. This is our story, really. And also today in France, in this country where cinema is considered as an art, there is a political will for 100% of pupils to encounter an artistic education during their schooling. So we have every reason to be optimistic because reaching the greatest number of students, it is very important, of course, but we must not give up on the requirements of this artistic education. I guess the research and reflection dimension is not necessarily the criterion that is most taken in account when it comes to young audiences. And I'm not nostalgic, but just remember there was a time when the greatest film thinkers were also the greatest pedagogues. The pedagogical question should be driving force behind thinking about cinema, I think. So maybe I wanted, and maybe we can do it later, to show you a film of this year, realized this year, because I wanted to say one thing. We are looking back over the 27 years of CCIG workshop film production, and you imagine how many films. It is really huge. And there is also this sociological interest of the production of films that are the mirror of the changing society. And they tell us about the concerns of the children. They record new unusual faces, places, and events. And this film, made by a workshop this year, I think it tells us what it is about in the mind of the children now. The time of the subject of the year was time in cinema, and we just discovered this film last week, so we can maybe watch it afterwards, talk about it. I don't know if you wish. So thank you for your attention. That's okay.
Thank you very much, Nathalie. Unfortunately, we have only 15 minutes left, so I would propose not to see the film now, but rather encourage everyone to have a look at the website and have a look at the films and rules of game which are proposed there to get an idea of the project. And if you wish, to pose your questions now to everyone, either questions on how this project functions or questions on the subject what Nathalie told about at the end, why it was finished or something, if this is something which is perhaps also related to a more general trend in film education. So please feel free to ask any question that you want, even if you are not familiar with the project. Just take your opportunity. I have a look at the Q&A and give you some time. We have two questions already, and I would go on to these questions immediately because we don't have many time. There is one from Italy who writes in the chat, not a question, but a consideration, from Al Guiarino. The evidence of value of CCIG is out of the question. I wonder how Cinémathèque was able to renounce a commitment that for us, for Italian institutions, as well as for others in Europe, was clearly identifying in its mission. I want to express my maximum support for the present situation and for the future. We need CCIG in our universe of action, research, and experimentation and work. I think this is quite a representative for many small institutions, small initiatives who worked with Cinéma Centre Jeunesse, who have been inspired by Cinéma Centre Jeunesse, because as Nathalie told us, it's an experimental form of film education. I think it, and I think for the development of film education internationally, this is a very important point, that we always need the small initiatives that experiment and that they're based on what Nathalie says, human relations, on people who are engaged and who share and who are diverse, because what is interesting in this project is the diversity of people who work together. I see a second, and the second, this was not a question, but a comment. The second question came from Michael Cannon, and I want to ask her if she wants to perhaps to tell us in person what's her question.
Michelle? Hello.
Hi.
Hello, Nathalie. Hi, nice to see you.
Hi, Michelle.
Hi, thank you so much for your presentation, which was so kind of heartfelt and important to hear. I echo all the sentiments of support that have been aired around Cinéma Sans Ton Jeunesse, especially what Jamie was saying about the influence it has had on his work. Indeed, I asked my question probably about 20 minutes ago, and you started to address many of the aspects in that question, which were around the demise, the general kind of decline in arts and humanities that we are certainly seeing in England, for various reasons can be discussed. But I was just wondering if you saw that the challenges that face the project or the program. How much is that a reflection of the wider context in which Sans Ton Jeunesse is working? Given that the Cinémathèque want to localize it and bring it all in rather than see outwards in an environment now with the pandemic where we are absolutely in need of these kinds of projects which internationalize, look at global issues, seek empathy and all this. So how is it a reflection of that?
So it's difficult to know the reasons, because the Cinémathèque told they want to refocus, but maybe it's for one time and then they will open again. I don't know. But no, I think this is the way they had to do, and of course we can say it's impossible to choose between making students coming to the Cinémathèque and such a project, because it's quite complementary, it's obvious. So there are economical reasons for that. So I'm not sure, Michelle, I understood really your question, but what I really improved last week is that people really need those kind of utopia, human things, and to be able to be responsible of things, and not always to be submitted to reasons that makes you do this that way or this way, and many, many projects for political reason. And this is very touching, what happens to Cinéma Sans Ton Jeunesse, because of course it's not only a little story. For me, it means a lot about the general situation. It's difficult for me to explain it in good English. sorry, but yes, it's not an isolated thing. I don't think so. You're right.
Okay, but I think the response that you've mounted has been fantastic. You know, not only the global international support, but the ways in which you have engaged the services of different agencies and how you've built up other structures, other supporting structures.
We are trying to do that, because it's a very, but something is beginning to yes. You mean in the past?
In the future.
In the future, it's like a puzzle. We have some pieces, but it begins because people are so involved, and of course there is the financial reality for the coordination, because sometimes it's too easy to say you just have to split the coordination into the partners. No, it's not so easy, because it has a hurt, this project, really. And of course it can be different, but there are things important, and we can do this online. We can do this without any coordination. It is, if people say that, they don't know really the project. They don't understand it really. And so that's why I'm not sure it will work, but I really hope, and we will be there at in October.
Yeah, I think Cinéma Centre Jeunesse, such as other French film initiatives, big ones like École Cinéma, and also what does the Service Pédagogique at the Cinémathèque Française, always was a kind of example for other countries, that an aesthetic approach and a film historical approach of film can be conciliated with a contemporary, with addressing young people of today with their concerns and their wish to express themselves. And I think it's an important counterpoint. It has been always an important counterpoint to tendencies that won't just focus on a general media education, which has no historical, real historical perspective, which has no real aesthetic approach, and which is more about communication than on what, how am I looking at the world, which is Cinéma Centre Jeunesse. And I think this is why there is this question, is it a general tendency that this bastion, I'd say, this bastion, France, bastion, I don't know how the English word would be, this French exception will rather stay alive, or is there a risk that there are within France tendencies that that tendencies in the general move of how public funding is done, how education, the educational sector is developing, that will endanger projects like this in the future. Excellent. And yes, there is someone, and I watch, if you don't want to answer directly, there is a question of Joanna Sinodinu. I don't know if you wish to pose your question yourself, or perhaps quickly I read it. It is so sad there is not enough money for art in Europe, unfortunately also in Greece. Imagine there are no art classes in senior high schools anymore. I think there's a general quest, there's really a general problem that the value of art education and film education, which is an art education, for the development of young people, for their personalities, for also for integration, is such so important, but which cannot really be counted in numbers or something. And that we have a tendency not to look at this and really to have this problem that it is pushed aside, I think. More. I don't know how you see this, Nathalie.
Well, it's difficult to, I don't know if the Cinémathèque is reflecting the global situation of France, and but there may be some specificity about the Cinémathèque. But you're right when you say that this to cinema giving us news of the world is no more the question. And it was a quote of Serge Danet, and cinema is not there for that in the French education, but it's always difficult to speak. It's difficult in English because I'm not very good at that. And it's difficult I can just say tendencies. And tendencies for me are always not to talk really about the subject. Never talk, you say all day, you always talk about education, but you never talk about education. And I always say, but people never are never in contradiction. They always say, okay, it's fine. You're doing education, cinema education, it's fine. I'm doing too. And that's all. There is no more real exchanges. It's very difficult to manage to speak really of that. You're always speaking around. So it's a kind of answer to you, because it's not in the center of thinking of cinema or of pedagogy or anything. Cinema education is, we speak about that for other reasons. even if it's cinema education and not media education. So it's difficult maybe to explain, but I think you...
Yes, and I think Cinéma Centre Jeunesse is an example that how important it is that different people from different backgrounds, such as teachers and artists and people working in film culture, and they're also in university people, work together to foster education in a very general sense. I think this is very important that we don't get closed down in our disciplines. And there's one more question I would like to go on. That is from Donk. One asked a very practical question: if the lectures of Alain Bergala, the initial lectures, are published on the website. I don't know. Do you want to answer to this, Nathalie?
Yeah, I can. So they are not on the website because they are very long, and they are not because they are 2 days. So you can't we are in a cinema theater and talking, and so we when we put a new question on the website, we are making a new video of the challenges of the question. Sometimes it's Alain Bergala who is doing that, sometimes it's another filmmaker. But as I said, it is like a conversation. It's something, if we were putting it like that on the website, I think it won't be really the good way to participate. But you can find on the website many, many resources linked to the training.
Yes, thank you very much, Nathalie. I read a last comment from Yona Bibu, who writes, quite an extraordinary initiative that is well based on a culture of acknowledgement of desires, longings, and challenges. All those involved in cinema, deep gratitude and congratulations for all your collaborative cine practice in the Cinémathèque. And I think this is a good last sentence. I invite everyone who is not so familiar with the project, go to the website. You have everything there. You have also film extracts, rules of the game, propositions how to work with this methodology, and see you perhaps in person.
And you also have the on the chat the reference of the film. I wanted to show you if you want to have a look on it. So thank you.
See you. I can't say see you, but have a nice day to everyone. And okay. Thank you to Nathalie.
Thank you to all. Bye.